I welcome you back to this presentation on analysis of determinate structures. Well, today's learning outcome would be to analyze a simply supported beam carrying moving UDL shorter than the span using influence line diagram. In the last presentations, we have seen how to analyze simply supported beam carrying single concentrated wheel load and simply supported beam carrying moving UDL longer than the span. So if you just try to recollect, I had given you some pictures where we can have moving tracked vehicles whose dimension of the track is smaller, and we are trying to talk about a situation where such kind of vehicle crosses the bridge. Now, to begin with, we have a small bookwork connected with a condition regarding how to place the moving UDL whose length is shorter than the span on a cross section to obtain maximum bend moment at the section when the UDL smaller than the span crosses the beam. Now, if you just try to look at this figure, so we have a simply supported beam AB of span L. We have a moving UDL of length Z. So the length of the moving UDL Z is lesser than the span. The intensity of the UDL is W kilonewton per meter. Let us assume the moving UDL crosses the beam from left to right. So if you just try to check here, the cross section is given, okay, at some section in the beam. Now C is the section at which we are trying to calculate the maximum bending moment that may develop, okay, when the UDL crosses on the beam. So the moment section C is defined, okay, the distance AC, which is nothing but small a, and the distance CB, which is nothing but small b, will be automatically defined. Here, the total length of the beam is the summation of, okay, small a plus small b. Now, since we are trying to find the maximum bending moment that may develop, okay, at C, okay, when the UDL crosses the beam, the very first thing that we will be doing here is we will write an appropriate influence line diagram, which is nothing but the influence line diagram for bending moment at C. The point of interest is this section C. Now the ILD for bending moment at C looks like a triangle. I hope all of you are familiar with this. The maximum ordinate is obviously at C, which is nothing but A into B by L. A here is the distance from, okay, A to section C, and small b is the distance from B to section C, and L is the span. So A into B by L will give you the ordinate, maximum ordinate in influence line diagram, okay, for BM at C. Now, the logic that we need to understand here is, okay, to get maximum bending moment at C, the moving UDL should be placed, okay, around C. That is, okay, some portion should be lying to the left of section C and the remaining should be lying to the right of C. Because if you watch the influence line diagram, the maximum ordinates, okay, the maximum ordinate is right under C, and around that we also have relatively, okay, bigger ordinates when compared to the ordinates present at the end. Like here, at A it is 0, at B it is 0, the ordinate keeps on increasing and reaches a maximum value at C. So we can understand that when the UDL is placed around C, okay, so we can expect to use or to get maximum area in the influence line diagram, and that will result in, okay, the maximum bending moment at C. Having understood this, let us try to place the UDL, okay, as shown in the figure. As you understand, the total length of the UDL is Z, okay, and obviously Z is less than the length of the span. Let us assume that X is nothing but a part of the UDL, okay, lying to the left of C, and obviously the length of the UDL lying to the right of C is Z minus X, because total length is Z. If I say this X, obviously that would be Z minus X. Okay, something like if I say total length of the UDL is 4 meters, and if this is X, it is nothing but 4 minus X. Now once I place the UDL like this, I can easily understand, okay, that I am trying to take, okay, the area, okay, under this particular UDL. So I would be trying to mark an ordinate, okay, to the left end of the UDL in the ILD, and again write an ordinate to the coinciding the right end of the UDL in the influence line diagram. So once I have defined my ordinates at the two ends of the UDL, okay, I can easily try to calculate the area in ILD under the UDL, okay, which needs to be multiplied by the intensity of UDL, okay, which will result in the value of bending moment, okay, at C for this position of load. Please understand, as X changes here, okay, the area also will try to slightly change. But here our objective is to see that we get maximum area here, okay, and that will result in maximum bending. So the point here is, what should be this X, okay, to get maximum area here, and obviously that will result in maximum bending moment. Now the first task here is, okay, to calculate the reaction for some defined position of the load. That means I have said that let X be the portion lying to the left of C and the remaining Z minus X to the right of C. For this position, I would like to calculate the reaction at support A. Okay, so once I get support reaction at support A, obviously I can calculate the bending moment at C. I am trying to take all forces to the left of C, hence I will limit myself only to calculate a reaction at A, that is BA. I will not be interested to calculate reaction at B, that is BB. Okay, now how do we calculate the reaction BA at support A? Okay, due to this position of load, I use a simple equilibrium equation. The equilibrium equation I am trying to make here is algebraic summation of moments due to all forces about point B equal to 0. Since I am trying to take about point B, I get VA. Correct? So that's the equilibrium equation I am trying to use here. So I am just trying to take the sign convention as clockwise positive. Correct? So how do I get the equation? Okay, let me start with respect to VA. There would be two terms, one due to VA and one due to UDL. Okay, so the moment of VA force about point B is VA into span, that is L, that is plus, clockwise, that is plus. Okay, you are trying to see this particular term, first term. Next, coming to the second term, that is due to the UDL. The total length of the UDL is Z, as you know, X plus Z minus X, again X will cancel, so Z. Z is the total length of the UDL. So total load would be, okay, here load is WKN per M, you multiply by Z, you get W into Z is the total load. So if we just try to watch here the term, we have got W into Z is nothing but the total value of that UDL. Next, I need to measure the distance from support B to the midpoint of this particular UDL. So how do I get that? So what I would be doing is, I will start from B, come to C, that would be small b, distance is small b, and then further move from C to the end of the UDL, that is x, and then come back by half of z. So that then that will give me the distance from point B to the midpoint of the UDL. So I first start from B, come to C, that is small b, and then further go up to the end of the UDL. So I will be trying to move further by x. So the distance from point B to the left end of the UDL is B plus 6. Now I come back by half the distance, that is Z by 2. So that is what I have written here. So B plus 6 minus Z by 2. So that is a distance from support B to the midpoint, okay, of the UDL lying to the left of total UDL. Okay, so that is equal to 0. That's what we are trying to say. Okay, algebraic summation of moment due to VA and moment due to UDL equal to 0. If I rearrange, I get the expression for VA. So what is the expression for VA? It's nothing but WZ by L. So that means this divided by L into B plus X minus Z by 2. So the first step would be to calculate a reaction at A. The next step would be to calculate the bending moment at C considering, okay, forces to the left of C. So how do I calculate bending moment at C? I'll be trying to take all forces to the left. I'm seeing two forces here. One is reaction VA, and only this part of the UDL, okay, is what I get. So I obviously I will have two terms in this expression. Okay, the first one would be obviously VA into A is the first term, minus total value of the load lying to the left of C is W into X. 1 meter it is W kilonewton, X meter is it is W into X. So we have W into X, and then we expect that to act at the midpoint, okay, of X. Hence the distance from the midpoint of this X to C would be X by 2. So that is how we have written here the expression for MC. But in the previous slide we have calculated the numerical value of VA. So I substitute the numerical value of VA, okay, and then express what is MC. So MC would be, so WZ into A, this A by L, then into B plus X minus Z by 2 minus W X square by 2. So this is the value of moment that we have got. Okay, I have rewritten that equation here. So we can easily understand that except X, all other things are constant in this equation. W is the intensity of load. Okay, Z is the length of that UDL. Small a is the distance of section C from left support A. L is total span. Small b is the distance of section C with respect to right support. So X is a variable. So Z we already defined. Okay, W we already defined. X is a variable. So we can easily understand that the only variable here is X. What is X? The length of the portion of UDL lying to the left of C. So if you start varying that, obviously MC keeps on changing. So we can try to even do a small program and then try to say, okay, when X equal to 0, what is the value of MC? That means all part of the UDL is to the right of C. And then once X starts to, you start pushing the UDL to the left, okay, X can keep on increasing, reach a maximum value of Z. Okay, so we can try to do a small program, and you can try to see for different values of X, you get value of MC. But we will also see that when we do such an exercise, okay, one at one value of X, okay, the bending will be maximum. Now, how are we trying to find at what value of X we are trying to get this value of moment, maximum moment? You try to do this simple thing. I hope you have studied this in mathematics. So the left term is MC is a function of X. So to extremize MC, so we try to differentiate, okay, this MC, okay, with respect to the variable X and force it to 0. Okay, so we are trying to do this exercise here for this particular expression. So once we do this, we are trying to get an expression as, okay, WZ by into A by L within brackets. So we have 0 plus 1 minus 0. So it's obviously nothing but just 1. Okay, if you try to differentiate this, it's 1 minus W by 2 into the differential of X square is 2X, and you force it equal to 0. And if you just try to look at this expression, W in the first term and W2 in the second term, okay, they can be eliminated. Okay, similarly, okay, in the second term, this 2, okay, will try to cancel out. Okay, and hence, okay, we are left with ZA by L, okay, minus X equal to 0. Okay, or we can try to say that X equal to ZA by L, X equal to ZA by L. So that means the length of the UDL that should be towards left of X is Z times A by L. But we will try to express the condition in a much better way. So what we are trying to do is, we are trying to say, in the previous slide, we have said X equal to ZA by L. This is the portion lying to the left of C. So what is the portion then? What is the portion lying to the right of C? So obviously it is Z minus X. So what is X? It's nothing but ZA by L. So we just try to substitute X here and then simplify. So we just try to simplify. So here on the RHS, okay, we have got Z as common. I can try to take Z as common. Then we have minus 1 minus A by L. And if we just try to simplify this further, you get this as Z into L minus A by L. Okay, and if we just try to check what is L minus A, L is total span, A is distance from left support to section A. If we just try to deduct, okay, AC from AB, what you get is CB, which is nothing but small b. So we are trying to say that Z minus X will be ZB by L. Okay, left hand portion is ZA by L, right hand portion will be ZB by L. This is what we are trying to say. So if X equal to ZA by L, then Z minus X is ZB by L. Now what we do is, we try to take the ratio of the two terms. Okay, so we try to divide, okay, the first term by the second term. So what we get is X divided by Z minus X on the LHS, and on the RHS we get ZA by L divided by ZB by L. So here Z and L are again common, I mean they get cancelled. So the expression, okay, simplifies to, okay, X divided by Z minus X equal to A by B. So this is the format in which we want you to remember this particular expression. Okay, so what does it imply? So if you just try to look at this, the same expression, okay, X divided by Z minus X equal to A by B. Now please understand, we are trying to calculate, okay, the maximum bending moment that will develop at C when the UDL moves, okay, on the beam. Correct? So please understand, the moment we define section C, okay, the beam is divided into two ratios. That is, what is the ratio? A divided by B. It's trying to divide the beam into two proportions, into one proportion. Okay, AC by CB. Okay, as C changes, obviously A and B will also change. Given section C, small a and small b, okay, take some numbers, okay, and we are trying to say the ratio is A by B. Now please understand, okay, the UDL is also divided, okay, in a proportion. Like for example, if this is X, that is Z minus X. So the proportion would be X divided by Z minus X. So what we need to understand here is, okay, to get maximum bending moment at C, okay, we try to tell that the section should divide, okay, the beam in the same ratio, okay, as it divides the span. So this is what we are trying to tell. To get maximum bending moment at C, okay, section C, which is given, okay, should divide the load in the same ratio as it divides the span. It is dividing the span in the ratio of A by B. Hence, in the same ratio, section C should also divide the load. That is, X by Z minus X should also be same. Okay, so this is a very important book work, and we have a strong condition here, okay, which will be used, okay, while solving numerical examples. Okay, when we take a numerical problem, okay, we'll try to use this condition, okay, to place the load appropriately on the beam, okay, and we will try to obtain the maximum bending moment at section C. So it was a very simple exercise here. Okay, so if you just try to just quickly recollect the concept that we have talked about in this particular workbook. Okay, so we were trying to understand how you should place the load to get maximum bending moment at C right? So we the first step was, okay, first understanding is, okay, so the load should be placed around C. That means one, some portion should be lying to the left, and some portion, the remaining portion, should be lying to the right. Why do we do this? Because if I try to do this, I'll be using maximum area in the ILD, because the ordinates are maximum, okay, near C, that is at this, in this particular region, right? So understanding that, we have placed the load properly. The first thing would be to calculate reaction VA, okay, and then right second step, trying to get an expression for moment at C, considering towards left, and since we have got VA towards left of C, I'll be substituting the expression that we would have got for VA. So having expressed MC, okay, the next thing is MC does vary with respect to X. So you differentiate MC with respect to X, equate to 0, and find what is X. Once you get what is X, you also find what is Z minus X. Okay, then take the ratio of X by Z minus X. Okay, you get this particular condition. So it's a very simple bookwork, important, okay, generally, right, when we try to take up this exercise. Okay, I hope you can easily manage with this bookwork. Now let us try to take a numerical problem, okay, connected with the moving UDL shorter than the span. Okay, now the problem is about a moving UDL 20 kN per meter, that's the intensity W, okay, of length 3 meters. The length of that is only 3 meters. Okay, it crosses a simply supported beam, okay, of span 15 meters. So the span is 15 meters. The length of the UDL is smaller than that. Okay, it could be 3 meters, anything. Okay, it is less than the span, is what we are trying to tell. Okay, and it crosses from left to right. So we are trying to calculate some information here with respect to this exercise. The first one is the maximum bending moment that develops, okay, at 6 at a section, which is 6 meters from the left support. That is, section C is defined. So we'll be using the condition that we derived, okay, just before this example. Same condition we are trying to take here to solve the first objective of this exercise. The second one would be to find maximum shear force, okay, at some defined section C, which is nothing but 6 meters from right support. Last time it was from left support, some section. This is a different section at which we are trying to find the maximum shear force. Okay, the next one is absolute maximum bending moment of the beam. So that means when the load moves from left to right, okay, at which section we get the maximum, okay, and that has to be the maximum of all maximums. Please understand, when the beam, when the load moves on the beam, each section, okay, over the entire length of the beam, there could be hundreds of sections, they will develop their own maximum values. So when we say absolute maximum, it is nothing but the maximum of all those maximums observed at various sections. So we are trying to find the absolute maximum bending moment in the beam. Similarly, we are also trying to calculate absolute maximum shear force in the beam, right? So each and every section will experience some maximum value of shear force when the load moves, okay, and we are trying to talk about the maximum of all those maximums, which are defined as absolute maximum shear force in the beam. Okay, next one, equivalent UDL over the entire span based on absolute maximum shear force. Now what it means, that means for this UDL 3 meters length traveling over a span of 15 meters, we have found absolute maximum BM. So we are talking about equivalent UDL. So that means what? Over the entire span. So if I have to get the same value of absolute bending moment, considering the same beam, okay, where the type of load we are talking about is UDL longer than span, okay, so for you to get the same absolute maximum, what would be the intensity of the UDL, okay, that I have to place over the entire length of the beam? A similar objective with respect to shear force, that is equivalent UDL over the entire span based on absolute maximum shear force. So we have calculated the absolute maximum shear force for this small length of the UDL. So what we are trying to say is, if I try to take the same beam, okay, and then if I have to get the same value of absolute maximum shear force in that beam, okay, what is the intensity of total load, okay, that I have to put on the beam. So we are trying to do all these, calculate all these objectives using the influence line diagrams. Okay, please understand, okay, you are still using the same influence line diagrams that we had used, okay, to solve a numerical example, okay, in SMP support beam carrying a single concentrate payload, or SMP support beam carrying an UDL of length longer than the span. So the influence line diagram does not change, okay, with respect to the type of loading, okay, it remains same. So let us start with the first objective or exercise here, that is to find maximum bending moment at 6 meters from A. So please understand, first one, we write the simple support beam, okay, it says span is 15 meters, then what is the type of load that is crossing the beam, UDL smaller than the span, what is the intensity of UDL, 20 kN per meter, what is the length of this UDL, 3 meters. This is defined as Z. So Z is length of the UDL, which is 3 meters, and small w is 20 kN per meter. It is crossing the beam from left to right. Okay, so given that, okay, so we try to define a section C. Okay, so here section C is at 6 meters from left support. Okay, it is at a distance of 6 meters from left support. So the moment we write section C here, okay, at a distance of 6 meters, so AC here is 6 meters, we can easily calculate what is BC, because the total span is 15 meters. If you deduct 6 from 15, what you get is 9. So right now this is small a, this is small b, okay, that is 6 and 9, and regarding total length of the beam is, okay, that is 15 meters. So the next thing that we would be immediately doing is write the appropriate influence line diagram. So at section C, what are we calculating? We are calculating the maximum bending moment. Okay, we are calculating bending moment. So I write ILD, appropriate ILD, ILD for bending moment at C. So how does the ILD for bending moment at C look like? Okay, looks like, it looks like a triangle with maximum ordinate at C. Okay, and the value that we get here is, okay, 3.6. Okay, as maximum ordinate. How do I get it? So that's the expression you can clearly see here. So A into B by L. So what is A? 6. What is B? 9. What is L? 15. So 9 into 6 is 54. Okay, 54 divided by 15. Okay, will give you 3.6. So that's what we have written here. Okay, so first complete the influence line diagram. Next, we need to place the load appropriately. So as we have been telling you in the previous book work, okay, to get a maximum bending moment at C, load should be placed around C, correct, around C. Now let us say that, okay, to the left of C, the length of the UDL is X, and to the right of C, it is Z minus X, and here please understand, the value of Z is 3 meters, so it is 3 minus X is what we have written here. Correct. I hope you are trying to understand. So we were writing Z minus X. Here Z is 3. Length of the UDL is 3. So this is what first we need to understand. Correct. Now once I have written the place the load like this, is it all right? Next I try to recollect the condition that we had derived. Now what is the condition? We try to say to get maximum bending moment at C, the section C should divide the load in the same ratio as it divides the span. How is it dividing the beam? In which ratio? Small a to small b. In what ratio is it dividing the load? X by 3 minus X. So now we equate the two. Is it alright? So we are trying to say X by Z minus X equal to A by B. That's the condition, derivation we have done. Okay, so if we just try to look here, the value of Z is 3, you replace, okay, Z with 3, small a with 6 and small b with 9. correct. So I have not done anything. I have just used that condition x by z minus x equal to a by b. I have just replaced z with the length of the UDL 3 meters and small a and small b as 6 and 9. So I am just trying to do some small simplification here. So that means if I try to multiply the numerator and denominators here or in this particular term, so I get 9x equal to 6 into 3 minus x, okay, or 9x equal to 18 minus 6x. If we just try to bring 6x to the LHS, so we get 15x, okay, equal to 18, or the value of x equal to 1.2 meters. So that means the portion of UDL, okay, that should lie to the left of section C is 1.2 meters. So if that is the case, then what is the portion lying to the right of C? That is z minus x, z is 3, 3 minus 1.2, that would be 1.8 meters. So we just try to check here. So to the left of C, I've written 1.2 meters. To the right of C, I've written 1.8 meters. Intensity of load 20 kN per meter. Okay, 6 meter, 9 meter. Okay, this is what we have written. Now, the moment I have placed the load, the next thing I will be trying to do is calculate the ordinates at the ends of the UDL. Calculate the ordinates at the end of the UDL. So this is what you have to watch. Okay, the next thing I am trying to do is, okay, calculate the ordinates at the end of the UDL. So one ordinate, okay, at the left end of the UDL, one ordinate at the right end of the UDL. I have drawn here. The next one is I have to calculate the value of this. What is the ordinate? It's simple. So what is the distance AC? 6 meters. So at 6 meters, the value is 3.6. How did we calculate? AB by L. Correct? So at this distance, okay, so a distance from A to the end of the UDL, how do I do that? 6 minus 1.2. Obviously, that would be 4.8. Okay, so at a distance of 4.8 meters here, what is the ordinate? 2.88. Okay, is what you get. Similarly, on the right side, okay, so we have also another end of this UDL, that is a front end, assuming the load is moving from left to right. So we are trying to say at B, that is 9 meters, okay, the ordinate is 3.6, okay. So distance from B to the front end of the UDL or right end of the UDL is 9 minus 1.8, okay, that would be 7.2 meters. So we try to say at 7.2 meters, what is the value? So that would be 7.2 by 9 into 3.6. Okay, that will give you 2.88. So we have calculated, okay, the ordinates at the ends, okay, of the UDL. So once you get this, the next objective would be to calculate the area, okay, right, bounded by the two ordinates. And one more important thing that you have to remember here is if you have placed the load properly, both the ordinates, okay, that is the ordinate, okay, in ILD at the left end of the UDL and the ordinate in ILD at the right end of the UDL will be having the same value, okay. Please understand this, okay. If you just try to place the load properly, okay, and if you try to calculate the ordinates, okay, at the ends of the UDL, right and left in ILD, they will take the same value. This you need to remember. If you get a different value, you have to go and check your calculations, right? So once you have calculated the ordinates, the next one is I would like to take the area of this particular portion, okay, because if I multiply this area by the intensity of load, I will be trying to get the benignment developed at C for this position of load, which is nothing but the maximum benignment that the section C will develop. Now, important, what we are trying to say is, okay, this portion, this shaded portion, if you just try to check this shaded portion, okay, will be calculated by adding the area of one rectangle, okay, right, whose height is 2.88 and whose length, okay, is nothing but the length of the UDL. So the distance between the two 2.88 ordinates, okay, is 3 meters, okay, and the height of this is 2.88, that is area of rectangle, plus, okay, area of that triangle, okay, above the rectangle, okay. So the summation of these two portions, okay, will give you the total area in ILD bounded by these two ordinates of values 2.88. Okay, so now we know how to calculate the area. One rectangle plus one triangle will give the total area. So we try to say that, okay, hence maximum bending moment C is equal to, again the same expression, intensity multiplied by area. How do you get the intensity? Just 20. How do you get the area? Two areas, one rectangle. How do you get the area of a rectangle? Okay, that is length into height. So what is length? 3 meters. What is height? 2.88 meters. So the first term gives you the first two quantities, will give the area of the rectangle. Plus, so we have got the second geometry, that is area of a triangle, which is nothing but half into base into height. So half is 0.5, as you can clearly see here. Okay, and base is obviously the length of the UDL, 3, and height is nothing but difference between 3.6 and 2.88, okay, which is nothing but 0.72, okay, is what we have got. Okay, so substitute, okay, simplify, and you get the value of maximum bending moment, okay, that will develop at C to be 194.4 kilonewton meter. Please remember this, because okay, we'll also be calculating absolute maximum BM, in which case you can refer this particular value. Please understand, if I try to place the load, okay, at any other position, okay, other than this, obviously there will be some value of bending moment which can be easily calculated as the intensity of load for that, okay, and the area corresponding to that position. We need to pick the area in ILD and the product of the intensity multiplied by the corresponding area in ILD under that position of load, okay, will give you the bending moment. So please understand, for no other position you get value of bending moment more than this. Okay, so let us try to go to the next objective. The next objectives are quite simpler when compared to this. Okay, the previous one also was simpler, but only thing is you should know how to place the load. Here the concept is very simple. Okay, so we want to know, okay, how to place this UDL so that we get maximum shear force at C. So first we define the section. So here we have given the section as 6 meters from right support. Okay, so here BC is given. Okay, so C is defined. So what will be AC? Total span minus 6, that is 9 meters. So for this case, small a is 9 meters and small b is 6 meters. The next thing that we do is we write an appropriate ILD. What do you mean by appropriate ILD? We write influence line diagram for shear force at C. How does it look like? Okay, it looks like this. Okay, so it has two right angle triangles, one below the base, one above the base, and the ordinate. Okay, so below the base is written as small a by L. So you can clearly see here, so small a is nothing but 9, L is 15, so 9 by 15 is 0.6, and small b is nothing but 6, so 6 by 15 is 0.4. So the ordinate, okay, lying below the baseline is 0.6, and the ordinate lying above the baseline is 0.4. And one more important thing, okay, the area, okay, of ILD below the baseline is negative, and the area above the baseline is positive. Correct? This is what we first do. The next thing is we have to place the load appropriately. How do you place the load appropriately? So we try to say that, okay, to get maximum shear force at C, okay, we have to place the ILD either in portion AC or CB, whichever is larger. Okay, so in this particular case, AC is larger than CB because AC is 9 meter, CB is 6 meter. I would like to place it in portion AC. Again, in portion AC, you can clearly understand that the ordinates are larger, bigger. Okay, so at C, and again goes on reducing, okay, when you move towards A. So obviously, I have to place the UDL in such a way that the front end of the UDL is at C, is what you need to understand, right? Okay, so if I try to move the UDL towards left, my ordinate or corresponding area keeps on reducing. So I should place the load such that I can get the maximum area in ILD. So step one, you'll be placing it either on AC or CB, whichever is larger. Having decided that, we are trying to place the load such that one end of the UDL is at C, okay, and the other end is, okay, towards the support, okay, in that corresponding region is what we are trying to do. So right now I quickly, okay, place the UDL appropriately. So look at this, I have placed the load appropriately. So once I've placed the load appropriately, my next step would be to calculate the area under that particular load in ILD. So first I would be trying to calculate ordinates at left and right. Right already it exists. I have to calculate ordinate only at the left end. So how do I calculate this ordinate? Similar triangle. So that means, okay, at a distance of small a, that is 9 meters, it is 0.6. At a distance of 6, so what is the value? Simple, 6 by 9 into 0.6 will give me 0.4. Once I've identified the ordinates at both left end and right end, I need the area. So how does the area look like? A trapezium. So how do I calculate the maximum shear force? Quite simple. Intensity multiplied by area. Intensity is 20. Area negative, please remember, minus of average of 0.4 and 0.6, the two ordinates, multiplied by distance between the two ordinates, that is 3 meters. Simplify, you get this as minus 30 kilonewtons. Please understand, this is the maximum shear force section C will develop, okay, when the UDL moves, okay, from left to right. Now please understand, for any other position of the UDL on the beam, and if you try to calculate the shear force at C using the same ILD, okay, the value of shear force would be much lesser than this. That is, okay, right now it is minus 30, okay, it's nothing but just the sign convention. That is, we know that, okay, left up is positive and left down is negative, okay, it's just the direction. So generally when we do the designs, okay, we would be worried about the magnitude and not about the sign, is what we need to understand here, that is up or down. Okay, the next one would be to get the absolute maximum bend moment. For this, please understand, for UDL shorter than span, we remember two rules, okay. So it's a simply supported beam. We are talking about simply supported beam. It occurs at the mid span, okay, for point number one. Point number two, how do you place the load? Symmetric, that means exactly at the midpoint, mid region. Okay, right, that's what we are trying to do right now. We just try to check here. So section C is not given, but we are assuming. Where are we assuming? Right at midpoint. If you assume it right at midpoint, please understand AC equal to CB. What is AC? 7.5 meters. What is CB? 7.5. Why? Total length of the beam is 15 meters. A and B are same. So how do I get the ordinate? I am writing the appropriate ILD. It's a triangle. Okay, how do I get the maximum ordinate here? AB by L. Or if NA equal to B equal to L by 2, it reduces to L by 4. So what is L? 15. 15 by 4 is 3.75. So you have written the appropriate ILD. Next, we place the load. If you place the load exactly at the midpoint, even if you use this condition, X by Z minus X equal to A by B, that means section should divide the load in the same ratio as it divides the span. So section C is dividing the span into two halves. Obviously, the load also should be divided into two halves. So we just try to check here. So total length of the UDL is 3 meters. So 1.5 meters to the left, 1.5 meters to the right. So that is how the UDL is placed. Now once you have placed the UDL properly, we try to calculate the ordinates at the end of the UDL. So I can easily calculate this. Okay, at 7.5 meters, it is 3.75. At 6, what is the value? So again, we've just tried to check the two ordinates at the left and right. For this position, again, has to be same. That is, the ordinates have to be the same. Now I calculate the area between the two ordinates. Okay, so area of the two ordinates, okay, in this particular case, is again that hatched portion. So this again can be divided into two parts. Okay, one rectangle and one triangle, just like what we did. Okay, so we are trying to multiply the area, okay, with this hatched portion. Okay, so that would be, okay, intensity into area. Intensity is 20, area of rectangle, okay, 3 meter is the length of the UDL, ordinate height is 3. So it is 3 into 3, the first term you are trying to see here, right, in this particular calculation. Okay, the next one is area of the triangle, half base height, 0.5, base is 3. Height is difference of the two ordinates, there is 0.75. If you just try to add, you get it as 202.5 kN meter. So please understand, I told you to remember the expression or the value that we had got for moment at sea, maximum bending moment at sea, which was defined at 6 meters from left support. It was definitely less than 200, now we can agree that, okay, yeah, this is correct. This is the maximum bending moment that we can get in the beam, right? So this is called as absolute maximum beam. A similar kind of a thing that we attempt, that is for absolute maximum shear force. So again, we remember two points, okay? So for UDL shorter than the span, here it occurs at the left support or at the right support, one of the supports. It does not occur simultaneously like what we said, okay, in the previous case, UDL longer than the span, it occurs simultaneously at both supports. Here it either occurs at left support or at the right support. When does it occur? When we place the UDL in such a way that, okay, one end of the UDL is at that support and the other end is on the beam, is what we are trying to tell. That means if you are trying to calculate the absolute maximum shear force with respect to left support, okay, then I have to place the UDL in such a way that the left end, rear end is at A and the front end is on the beam. However, if I am trying to calculate the same quantity considering right support, so the front end of the UDL should be at B and the rear end should be on the span. That's how I place. So having understood this, first I draw the appropriate ILD. Since we are trying to say it occurs at A, we are talking about ILD for reaction at A. Okay, so I hope you know it's a right angle triangle. The maximum value of 1 is at A. Okay, that is at support A. At support B, it is 0. Okay, now we place the load properly. So one end of the UDL is at the support. Okay, then the other end is on the beam. So this is how you place. So this is 3 meters. So this is 12 meters. Put together is 15 meters. So my next task would be to calculate the ordinate at the end of the UDL. That would be 0.8. So once I get the ordinate, I calculate the area. Okay, so that is area of the trapezium. So I can get my maximum shear force at A as intensity multiplied by ordinate in ILD, okay, which would be 20 into average of the two vertical ordinates, 1 and 0.8, separated by the distance. So that would be 54 kN. And if you just try to recollect the value of shear force we had computed, okay, in the previous case, okay, was less than this numerical value. Okay, so coming to last two small simple things, we are also trying to calculate equivalent UDL over the entire span based on absolute maximum bending moment. So we imagine that, okay, we have a UDL spread over the entire length of the beam, which we are defining as equivalent UDL. So what we are trying to say is, if I place an UDL over the entire length of the beam, what should be that intensity of this UDL to get the same value of absolute maximum BM? So we already have calculated absolute maximum BM for the given load, which happened to be 202.5 kN. Okay, for this kind of a loading, the maximum bending moment occurs at the midpoint. The value is WL square by 8. I just equate WL square by 8 with that absolute maximum bending moment. I rearrange, simplify. I try to calculate what is WE. The span is 15 meters. You get it as 7.2 kN meter. So please understand, equivalent UDL is a very simple task here. What we are trying to tell is, okay, what should be the UDL that I have to place over the entire length of the beam to get the same absolute maximum BM you have calculated in the numerical problem. Okay, the same kind of exercise we are attempting for shear force also. Okay, so let W be the equivalent UDL placed on the beam. Okay, now the absolute maximum shear force is 54 kN already computed, and for a simply support beam UDL over the entire length, the maximum shear force occurs at the support. The value is WL by 2. I equate the two, that is WL by 2 equal to 54. I try to calculate WE, and the value of WE also happens to be, in this case, 7.2 kiloton per meter. So the last two things are again simple, trivial. Okay, once you are trying to equate WL square by 8 with absolute maximum BM, here you are trying to take WL by 2 and you are equating it as absolute maximum, that is not BM, that is absolute maximum shear force. Okay, you get the value of equivalent UDL. So this completes the discussion with respect to the next type of problem that we were trying to talk about. Okay, that is UDL whose length is shorter than the span. Okay, so we will try to take up in the next class or next presentation how to analyze simply supported beams subjected to two concentrated loads, okay, at fixed distance.